Hello dear students, once again welcome to Meet Science class. Today we have the part 4 of meat preservation, that is the last part of this series of meat preservation lectures. So in part 4 we are going to talk about three different methods of preservation. One is drying, another is irradiation, another is chemical method of preservation. So altogether these three are quite long, but for the undergraduate students I have to make everything short. Actually each of this method can be talked for about 1 hour lecture. So I will go everything little bit briefly. The first is drying. It is also called as dehydration. So drying is actually removal of water from meat, and that will concentrate the solutes or soluble substances and nutrients, and the moisture will be unavailable to the microorganisms. So there will be no availability of water for microbial growth, and the preservation will happen due to the stoppage of microbial growth. And this availability of water, I have discussed earlier also, it is expressed as water activity when I was talking about the principles of preservation. So normally drying reduces the water activity to a level of 0.6 to 0.86, and that's how it prevents the microbial growth. So this is very old technique, but still nowadays it is used. Some of the very famous dried meat products like biltong in South Africa, pemmican jerky in North America, and charqui in South America. So sometimes salt is also added during drying of meat, and that gives added effect, that extract the water by osmosis and become more effective preservation. In case of biltong and charqui, salt is actually added. So here is the picture for famous dried product, as I said, biltong and jerky. So generally pre-cooking should be done before drying. So meat should be cooked first, then it will have better drying, and also it will reduce the lipolytic activity, that is the enzymes present in meat that causes lipolysis and leading to rancidity. Moreover, rancidity does not develop when the moisture is 1.5%. But if we reduce the moisture to such a level, the flavor will be affected and also the texture will be very hard. So we cannot go to such a low level of moisture. Rancidity can also be avoided by gas packing. So we are going to talk about it in packaging section. The moisture percent of dried meat, if it is too low, then only the bacterial growth can be prevented, but it should not be beyond 10%. Preferably the dried meat should have a moisture content below 10%, then only we can prevent the growth of molds like the yeast and other fungus. And if the moisture percent is beyond 10%, then after some week the penicillium or aspergillus, this kind of fungus, can grow. So now we will briefly talk about the drying methods. The old method is sun drying. So this is done by keeping outside on the sun, but it's a very very slow process, and such dried meat will be very hard, and the rehydration will be very slow and poor. So the meat will be very tough and rehydration will be poor. Then there is hot air oven. The oven, we can keep the meat, and sometimes we can have controlled humidity. So you can, if we keep the humidity low, then the drying process will be faster. And there are further special kind of drying oven, which is also called as cabinet dryer, that is used in the industry for large scale drying purposes. But in most of these drying mechanism, there will be a surface dehydration, and a thick hard layer will be formed on the surface of the dried meat, that is called case hardening, which makes it somewhat difficult to chew and swallow. Now some of the aspects of drying I will discuss, like physical aspect of drying, like the size of the meat that has got an important connection about the time required for drying. It is very simple. If the size is bigger, it will take more time. Similarly, heat damage is characterized by toughness, grittiness and burnt flavor. So when we go for oven drying, there will be toughness, some grittiness or some kind of burnt flavor. High fat content. If the meat has got high fat content, the heat transmission will be slow, so it will take more time, particularly when the fat content is more than 35%. Generally, a low quality meat or low grade meat is preferred for drying purpose. If overcooking is done, then the connective tissue, I told earlier, particularly the collagen, it get converted to gelatin, and such dried meat will have better rehydration or reconstitution. Whereas if it is undercooked meat, then the drying will be slow and reconstitution will be poor. Then some of the organoleptic aspect, that is the eating aspect or eating quality of dried meat. For long term storage, dried meat must be kept in airtight and moisture proof container. So why airtight? Because there will be lipid, and if there is air, there will be oxidation. And the dried meat, it will have a tendency of absorbing water. So when we pack it, it should be moisture proof. No moisture should go inside. Restriction of oxygen will maintain the flavor of dried meat for 12 months at 15 degrees Celsius. So if we can store the dried meat without oxygen, we can store it for 12 months at 15 degrees Celsius. Main changes during storage are caused by Maillard reaction. So during the heating, there will be Maillard reaction, and that continues, and sometime it causes unpalatable effect after 6 months. Presence of oxygen during storage of dried meat at high temperature can cause a paleness or yellowness. Now there is a modern drying that is called freeze drying. This is a modern technology in which water is removed by sublimation. That is, from solid state directly it goes to vapor state without being liquid. So the meat will be frozen and directly it will be dried under vacuum at a low temperature. So freeze drying of meat is much beneficial and the quality of meat will be much better. Here such a dried meat will have better reconstitution or rehydration properties. So when we do the freeze drying, it will absorb the moisture back easily. That is the rehydration. The nutritive quality will be better and acceptability will be better. So in case of freeze drying, the meat structure relatively undamaged because of the better way of drying, and particularly if the freezing is done in a fast freezing. And freeze dried meat must be kept moisture proof. As I said, in case of any dried product, it should be packed in a moisture proof container, since the dried products will absorb the moisture, that is called hygroscopic. At the present time, beef, pork, chicken and shellfish are preserved by freeze drying, but it is relatively costly because of the modern techniques and different kind of special facilities are required. So freeze drying is comparatively costly, but the quality of the meat, the properties of the meat, the storage life of the meat will be far better. So quickly I will tell the freeze drying procedure. It is done in 3 steps. That is, first is pre-freezing, second is primary drying, and then secondary drying. So pre-freezing is the meat has to be properly frozen at minus 40 degrees Celsius, preferably in fast freezing, and then dried under vacuum for 9 to 12 hours at a low temperature in plate heat exchanger. At a vacuum means about 1 to 1.5 millimeter mercury pressure. So here the ice crystals get sublimated. So frozen meat will have ice, and that ice will undergo sublimation where the moisture will evaporate directly, and there will be not much high temperature. Then there is primary drying. So free and immobilized water of meat which is frozen, that constitutes about 90 to 95% water, that is removed in the first phase, that is the primary drying. Then in the secondary drying, it is done at a high temperature. So first phase is done at a lower temperature because this part of the moisture can be removed easily. But there is some amount of bound water, which I have told earlier. So to remove this water, we need to have little bit of higher temperature. That is done in secondary drying. The process has been largely used for the preparation of dehydrated meat soup mixes. Nowadays, several meat soup mixes or powders are available for directly making the soup. So that kind of drying is used in this freeze drying. So here is freeze dried meat loaf. Now I will go to the second method of preservation, that is irradiation. So radiation is the emission and propagation of energy in the material medium. So electromagnetic radiations are in the form of continuous waves capable of ionizing molecules in their path. So radiation can destroy the microbes, especially by damaging their DNA or sometimes RNA, and also cause ionization of the water inside, and thereby it can damage the bacteria and become useful for preservation. So here is quickly about the irradiation of food. It is used for other vegetable items also for different purpose, like preventing the sprout, for insect disinfestation, even for other sanitization. But especially in case of meat, it is used to kill the pathogens or for extending the shelf life. So here is ultraviolet radiation, that is we call UV rays, which has got wavelength of 100 to 300 Armstrong, are visible and they are bactericidal. Spores and molds are more resistant in case of UV rays, and yeasts are comparatively even more resistant. Main thing in case of UV radiation is it has got poor penetration ability, hence it is suitable only for the surface decontamination or killing of the microbes on the surface. Therefore, this UV rays can be used only in case of aging to control the growth of microbes on the surface. Then there is another kind of radiation that is called ionizing radiation. That is, this radiation, when it pass through the food material, it causes ionization. So that is mainly the gamma rays produced by the isotopes of cobalt-60 and cesium-137. This kind of ionizing radiation has got excellent penetration power. It can enter up to 30 centimeter. So the gamma radiation produces desired effect only during food radiation or irradiation, and the effect will not be there once the source of irradiation is removed. So sometimes this irradiation can be done on both sides, and thereby we can use the thick packets for irradiation. The main features of an irradiation plant are the irradiation room, which contains the source of ionizing radiation. This I am going to explain later. Now there will be automatic conveyor to transport the meat packets. So here it is, the irradiation facility. So there is one entrance of the packets. Here is the radiation source kept deep below the ground in the water source, and irradiation happens here. The product get irradiated and comes out and goes out. But the whole building will be separated with a very, very thick concrete wall for protecting the radiation source. So what is the application for irradiation? Like decontamination of food ingredient. So in case of vegetables and many other foods, we can decontaminate or we can kill the microbes or yeast and mold. It is used for reducing the number of pathogenic microorganisms, especially Salmonella, Campylobacter, Listeria in meat and meat products. And it is mainly used for extending the shelf life in case of meat and meat products. Effectiveness. So pathogens such as Salmonella, Campylobacter are very sensitive at very low dose. As the dose increases, the microorganisms are more affected, but a higher dose can affect the organoleptic quality, that is the taste of the meat. Irradiation with 2.5 kilo gray on poultry carcass can eliminate the Salmonella and double the shelf life at 5 degrees Celsius. A dose of 50 to 100 kilo rat, this is another unit, can enhance the shelf life of fresh meat, cuts and sterilize the pork, poultry and fish. These are the effectiveness of the irradiation. What is the effect on the eating quality or organoleptic changes? A dose of 5 kilogray or above can produce a odor or flavor changes and make it somewhat unacceptable. That is called catty odor. This is due to the formation of sulfur containing substances like hydrogen sulfide, carbonyls and amines. So beef is more affected with this. Higher dose and catty odor or off odor happens more in case of beef, causing the change in the odor and flavor. Pork is much less affected with this. So to reduce this effect beyond 10 kilogram, first we should freeze the meat. But in case of poultry, at minus 18 degrees Celsius, then we should expose it to irradiation. Then the undesirable effect will be less. So what are the practice or methods? There are three different practice. One is radurization, which is a low dose, about 0.75 to 2.5 kilogram. Irradiation is to increase the shelf life. Meat can be stored for 5 weeks at 3 degrees Celsius with this dose. Then there is radisidation, which is equivalent to pasteurization. Here the irradiation is about 2.5 to 10 kilogram. Specifically, it is applied to kill some of the specific organisms and it will increase the shelf life without any adverse effect. Then the third is radapatization, which is a higher dose above 10 kilogram. This is completely to destroy all the microorganism. So thereby it will have an effect like sterilization. So completely it will kill all microbes and meat will be almost like sterilized. So this meat is first frozen, then subjected to radiation. So here there is not much increase in temperature, but sterilization happens. So it is also called as cold sterilization. Now the third part of today's lecture, that is the chemical preservatives. Actually, I have already discussed about curing and smoking. Those are also to some extent like chemical preservation. This part also should have come with that, but I could not tag with this. So any substance which is capable of inhibiting or arresting the process of spoilage, that is any substance which can prevent the growth of microorganisms or stop their growth, that can be considered as a preservative. So preservatives in that sense are classified into two categories. One is class 1 preservative, which are of natural type like salt, sugar, acetic acid, and the second category, class 2 preservatives, which are synthetic chemicals like benzoic acid, sorbic acid, propionic acid. In addition to all these, sulfur dioxide, sodium nitrite, sodium nitrate are also permitted as preservative. But only thing here is they should be pure, safe and non-toxic. Therefore, they should be used in a safe level. So here some of the preservatives which are used for different purpose, their action and dosage is explained. One is organic acids and their salts. These are used for reducing the pH. They act by reducing the pH, prevent the growth of bacteria and molds and yeast, and the dose is 0.5 to 5 gram per kg. There is sodium and potassium benzoates or sorbates. They can particularly prevent the growth of yeast and molds, so they are commonly used in case of pickles, in many vegetable pickles and also in meat pickle. The dosage is 0.5 to 1 gram per kg. Then there is sodium or potassium metabisulfite. They are also antifungal, prevents the slime formation, and they are suitable for using in sausages. Dose 0.5 to 1 gram per kg. Then nicin and natamycin, these are antibiotic. Even tetracycline, tylosin, these are the antibiotic can be used in food preservation. Especially they are commonly used in cheese and canned fruits, and in some meat and meat products can be used up to 500 ppm. Then there is sulfites or sulfur dioxides. They prevents the oxidation and enzyme activity and somewhat antimicrobial. Sulfur dioxide can be used in sausage. These are up to 500 ppm. Then finally, about the some specific chemical preservatives are called antioxidant. So to understand that, first we should understand the oxidation or rancidity. So oxidation or rancidity leads to unpleasant odor developed during storage. So what happens? All fatty acids, lipids, basically they are triglycerides. So those triglycerides undergo either hydrolysis due to the enzymic activity, or there is oxidation leading to peroxide formation, and that is more influenced by presence of light. So all this thing happens more when there is more unsaturated fatty acids, which I have told earlier. When there is more unsaturated fatty acid or polyunsaturated fatty acid, especially fish, poultry, pork, there it is more and the oxidation is more. So to prevent all this type of oxidation and rancidity, we used to have chemical antioxidant, and they can prevent this oxidation earlier days. But nowadays there is more awareness about the use of this chemical antioxidant, and more of natural antioxidants are being found to replace them. So here are some of the antioxidants: citric acid, which is 0.01 to 0.03% maximum used as antioxidant; BHA, butylated hydroxy anisole, which is 200 ppm can be used; BHT 200 ppm. These are the most common. However, nowadays sodium ascorbate and tocopherol, that is the vitamin A and vitamin E, they are now found to be more suitable to replace the chemical antioxidant. Now finally, what are the limitations of these antioxidants? As I told, the chemical antioxidants has got some harmful effect, especially when it is used beyond the permissible limit. Sometimes they can cause even cancer. Therefore, there is a more awareness to limit them, and more of natural antioxidants are coming into the use. So sometimes they cause the alteration in food characteristics, sometimes health problems, and may increase the sodium level and causing hypertension. Nitrite sometimes cause poisoning, or if it is used at higher level, it is nitrosamine, which is carcinogenic, I told earlier, in case of cured and smoked meat. Antibiotics, if it is used more, it may lead to microbial resistance. And humectants, it's a kind of chemicals which are used for intermediate moisture meat. So this is briefly I have discussed about three different methods today. That is, one is drying or dehydration, another is irradiation, and the lastly chemical preservatives. So with this I am completing the preservation aspect of meat and meat products. Next we will go for the processing of meat and meat products. Thank you. You should read details from the printed note I have already given. Thank you.